So I got with me here on Discord. We have Bombling from the 7th, and we got Claustro from PMP. In theory, if they talk, you should be able to listen to them. So as they're going to start speaking, you let me know if you need me to adjust the volumes, okay? So this is something new we're attempting. The idea behind this is to do this once a week and analyze the patch notes. This occasion we have, the city sieges, the new gear, some of the changes on the character. So I'm gonna start solo. Kill them all with fight round one. So this patch happened last Saturday. Okay, so we got the city sieges. Let's start with that. We got the city sieges. So, all right, let me see how I'm gonna do this. So, Bombling, what do you think about the city sieges? Good or a bad thing that they came into the game?
I think we should maybe start with the introductions.
Okay. So we got Bombling. He's from the 7th Legion. He plays a Bright Wizard. I'm assuming some of you might have seen him stream as well. And from the Destro side, we got Claustro. He's from PMP. He also streams, if I'm not mistaken. So say hi, guys, I suppose.
Hey guys, volume check. How's the volume on both Bombling here and
Good evening, guys. I'm Claustro.
You guys can hear them okay? Both? Let's see if I'm gonna reply. Come on, give us some feedback.
If you guys don't give
Good. Yep.
feedback, we will.
Yeah. Okay. Everybody says it's fine. Yep. Okay. There we go. So you're both good.
Perfect.
Start with the cities. Is that gonna be okay?
Sounds good. Yes, let's dive
Okay.
into it.
All right. So the cities came out. Is a 24 versus 24. So the easy question is it a good thing they're out or a bad thing?
Well, I think new content was overdue on the server, first of all. I think the last time we got the new really big content was maybe the forts, especially for the PvP part. We did get some instances in terms of Bastion stats, and that's been a hot topic for many people. Like, why am I forced to do PvE? Why can't I get PvP gear?
Yeah.
Well, guess what? We got PvP gear now, and we got cities 24 on 24 instance fighting, and it's wonderful.
Okay. Claustro, what are you thinking about them?
I agree. We will have summons in front of us where we need to collect this gear. So we're going to be occupied for a long, long time with grabbing the pieces we want. So it's good. Perfect timing as well.
There are a couple of worries from people. The one is what happens when there's a pre-made warband and there's a pack warband? You think there should be some sort of protection for that? Let's hear from Claustro first.
Well, in some sense, of course, it should be some kind of protection. It's never fun for the underdog to fight an organized warband. I had the pain this morning to actually be in one of the organized warbands, and the order warband only had four healers inside the city, and it was no opposition at all, as you can figure out with
Yeah.
the four healers. So, how to implement it, I'm not sure, but if they can, it would be lovely to have some kind of check at least, so you have 2-2-2 or something like that.
So speaking of implementations, I
Yeah.
think there is a system in place, and I'm not sure how much the devs have talked about this, and I don't have confirmation it's actually in there. But I personally got a first-hand feeling that there is a system that will hard match any pre-made queuing up as a full pre-made, as a full warband versus another full warband queuing up. So the defenders will always go in, and no instance will start before an instance is full of defenders. So if I go in on order side and Destro is attacking Aldorf, if I queue up with a full warband, whoever is in queue on Destro with a full warband will take priority in the queue to get in against us. So there is a little bit of a matchmaking going on there, but I'm not sure how aggressive it is.
Okay, at least we know there is something because I'm just transferring some of the worries from the people from my stream. So it's nice to hear how that, how do people that play mainly Order and mainly Destro, they react to these type of things. Okay, so with the cities comes the new sets as well. Two sovereign sets and one warlord. We're going to look at them in a moment. I need to position fixture in there to have a look. So as far as the patch goes, besides the cities, the main one is the cities, the new gear, and a couple of changes on the characters. Everything else is, you know, it's light stuff. Before we move on, I just have one more question for you guys for the cities. Actually, there's two questions. One is mine, one is from Wanaka, who couldn't make it. He asked me to ask this question to you guys. Okay. My question is this. Do you think people, I mean, in prime, there's a worry that on prime, people that play European time, the prime time, they will never see a city. And so far, it's kind of like proving right. Do you have any thoughts on that? Like, how is it going to be for people to acquire this set? Bombling?
I got a lot of thoughts about it, but I think it's pretty much out of the hands of the player base and the devs right now. It's just due to the circumstances of, if it's European prime time, there's a lot of fighting going on. There's a lot of guild warbands roaming around.
Yeah.
Some of them more focused on locking zones and defending and attacking keeps. Some more just roaming around enjoying their gear and coordination. And the zone's kind of stalemate naturally because of this fact that it's a lot of organized opposition on both realms. So attacking a keep with organized people inside and outside is going to be really, really rough. And it requires some sort of coordination realm-wide that we haven't been forced to do yet. So I think it's going to take some adjustment time to see EU pushing zones.
Okay. Claustro, any thoughts on this?
Yeah, it will take some time. I'm usually one of those EU prime time players, and I expect this to take about a year.
About a year?
Lucky. Yeah.
Okay, fair enough.
We still have players in PnP who doesn't have full invader or didn't have it until they open up the force, for example, because we play during EU prime time and we kind of only play on these 3 days where we have the warbands. So for some of our players, it have been a really rough road to get invaders. Okay. I know for one of the 24 versus 24 we had, I know that the 7th were stacked in full invader or full best in slot gear, while we had 6 players in full invader in the warband. So it won't be the same approach this time because the defending the losing side also get rewarded in the series. But it might be close to that. But for the winning, the pushing side, and this Destro at the moment.
Okay. So before we move on, just a question from Wanak. I would like to ask this question because he asked me on the stream earlier. The question is this. Do you think, and I'll start with Claustro first on this one, I'm trying to go one and one the questions. Do you think that Order and Destro, or Destro and Order, will start trading maps in order to get to the cities?
Yes.
Yes?
Yeah. I think both sides will. It will be not during the prime of EU. I think it's too many big organized guilds out to be able to throw a zone for it. But daytime EU, yeah. Nighttime EU.
Mm-hmm. Bumbling?
I like to be too transparent for my own good here. So I was in a ragball defense earlier, and I was racking in kills left, right, and center because the cauldron is really good against unorganized forces. So I can just start last hit them with the random AoE throwing around. And I was sitting there thinking, I really want to go to the city, but I also really want to kill these guys. So I was kind of torn. I had the little devil on one shoulder and the angel on the other, debating internally if, do I want to play left-handed here or do I want to play full tryhard? So yeah, there is a part of, do the defenders want to throw zones if they feel that their realm or their own abilities, for that matter, is incapable of pushing to the enemy city?
Okay, so here's like a comment, a funny comment anyway. So why not step down, kill half of them now, step down and kill the other half in the city, you know? You can have fun on both sides. Okay. Right, the rest of the patch, guys, is some stuff they did about exploit the getting out of combat by living in guild. I like the fact that, you know, when the patch notes have a lot of things, I like it. It seems that they're trying to take care of the game overall. But that is...
quickly with a comment here about patch notes. There was a time on Return of Reckoning where they gave reasoning and explanations for each of the patch notes. And I really love that, because when I go back in the archives and check some of the older patch notes, they have like one or two lines of just explaining where is this coming from. Because for this very example, fixed an exploit to get out of combat by leaving a guild. I don't have any experience, and I can't theorycraft about why is this an issue, who was doing this. Why do we need this sort of change? If that was one line explaining so people can't avoid getting killed or whatever, it's just like, yeah. Okay, it's, people used it like a war report.
Yeah, that is something the community always had a problem with. Sometimes the patch notes and the lines are not self-explanatory, and we always wonder. I remember one patch a couple of weeks back that said, I was reading a tooltip, but it's related to it, that said, increases your armor by a lot. You
dum,
know,
dum, dum.
What is a lot? What is a lot? You know.
Yeah.
So yeah, it needs to be clear. That is definitely. I think everybody agrees on that. World added a God of Chaos chapter 1, preventing filthy, empathetic players from killing the chapter NPCs. Okay, that sounds a little bit aggressive.
I like the little involved wording there. Pathetic,
yeah.
Players, not just players killing. But...
Yeah, that was it. Yeah, actual, you're right. That's the Melee Quick Herder ammo buff tooltip. Right, scenarios further down on the patch note. The manager to crash, that's good. No more crashing.
So apparently we saw that yesterday night in European time and
yep.
Beginning of NA times where we had a city siege going. And I think from Aldov City Siege 6 to Instance 9, all of them were stuck in Stage 3 preparation. And apparently the scenario manager is linked to the city sieges, so I would just like
well,
to throw that
it, out. It is an instance, so it should be linked there. But
yes.
The on this part, the fixer bug causes the scenario manager to crash, so that might be related to that, to the stacked city. So I think that little note here on the patch note, the fixed one by causing scenario manager to crash, might solve that problem, number one. Number two, Natherul says, I need to add reasoning to fix an exploit.
I think my comment was more in general. Like, whenever there is a change, it's nice to know where it's coming from. If people are exploiting, you don't necessarily need to explain why exploiting is bad. I think most of us can understand that. Mm-hmm. But if there is a change, like Rift can now pull 72 players at a time, I would kind of need to know why this is a change that you guys need to implement. Just as a random extreme example.
Okay. Yes?
I agree. It's a way to prevent us players to cause this conspiracy theories about order bias, the Destro bias, or people running to the forums and doing these huge wine threads. So it could be a great addition to the patch notes to stop the saltiness away.
Yeah, just a little bit more so we know what's going on, basically. A lot of people don't get why things happen. Okay.
Also,
yeah.
When any of the developers or anyone on the our team comes out in one of the topics and explain, this is why we do this, everyone on the server pretty much knows that this is their server, we are guests here. They do as they seem best fit for the server, and we just have to accept that. If I can go in and read, okay, this is the reasoning, I completely disagree with it, but I know in the back of my mind, okay, this is their server, they have the last say, this is what they deem to be the best explanation. It's kind of like a final say when they give the explanation, at least to me.
Well, I think people always, the problem with people is not always the changes, it's the why. That's the thing that really eats inside of them, I think, sometimes. So it's good to know why something happens. But on the other hand, just to be trying to be as fair as possible, I don't know how easy it is to write those extra two lines. You know how much time it's going to take for every little thing they do or whatnot, but definitely always been an issue and everybody wanted a bit more information coming out. But like you said, their server and that's it. So on scenarios again, optimized package handling and improves messages in mergeable and part drop scenarios. Also good. This one is the one that I like for scenarios myself. Allow capturing the flag in College of Corruption when standing in the middle part closest to the flag as well. If you remember that scenario, if you were standing in the flame in the little hole in the middle, you didn't get any contribution capturing the flag. You had to be around the gray area And I kind of like that because people didn't know it. It was a nice way of actually, you know, playing around it. Now it's going to be easier to capture the flag because it's a wider area for people to stand on. I don't know if that's a good or a bad change there. Definitely whoever has the most melee is going to be benefiting from that.
I'm kind of debating the few experiences I've had in that scenario. Sometimes you just fight around the flag and you end up in that little pit. And if there's like three fat orcs and a chopper and you're stuck down there, there's no chance you can actually jump out of it. So you're just like stuck in this little murder pit. So I don't know how I feel about that.
Claustro, what are you thinking about this change? Do you do scenarios?
I do, but to be honest, I don't have that much information about it. I know that I can get stuck inside that little pit as well on my shows, and well, I always blame the orcs for it.
Blame the orcs. It works. Well, the thing is, because I do a lot of scenarios, and I love them. I've done hundreds, not to say thousands of them. The specific one, it was a bit of a trick, because if you have a lot of tanks that can sit in there, you have a definite advantage. And since usually Destro has a lot more melee, they can stand there longer. That will give, I think, an advantage on the melee side. Not necessarily the Destro, because Orde is trying to play a little bit more melee. So that change, I think, gives a bit of an advantage on the melee train that can stay in there, whether it's Orde or Destro.
From a logical point of view, if you're standing closest to the flag in the little pit, regardless if it's on purpose and you can't get up, or if you're just standing there to fight, it makes sense that when you're standing closer to the flag that you're participating in capturing it. At least in a way,
yes, but you know, the scenarios have different mechanism, and I kind of enjoyed that mechanism that was different from Black Heron, that you have to be next to it. It actually made you stand in specific locations. It made it more interesting than just, you know, mindlessly going in the middle. That's why I liked it. But sure. Like Rasen said, that's too bad. I was like stealing the point from people who just stood in the middle. It was also, you know how to play or not. But anyways, I don't think it's a bad change. You know, make things
that kind of brings us into, I think, Natherul. I'm sorry for naming you here, Nath. One of the devs said previously, a few months ago, that too many hidden mechanics is not necessarily a good thing, because new players coming in, standing on the flag and getting ninja capped by someone standing on the upper ground in the outer circle of this flag, they will feel very cheated and this is a shit game and overreact and maybe not come back. Hidden mechanics are not necessarily good, and too many of them is an issue, in my opinion.
Okay, you say hidden mechanics, right? So what do... Natherul, because I'm hosting this, and for what you're typing, if you want to jump in, please feel free. Just let me know to move you to the right channel. Well, the hidden mechanics thing you mentioned, it's not a hidden mechanic. It's the mechanic of the scenario. The thing is, how many people would go to, let's say, Roar Wiki to read about it? How many people that play and know it are going to be bothered to communicate with their side and tell them, when I do the scenario, tell my side, step here, step, you know, stand there. It's also a matter of, you know, communicating within the player base between them. You know, it's not so much hidden as not people going around to find out about it, I think. So we have to look at perspective of the player's base, that we need to communicate and talk on the chats, not just do it like that.
Hi, it seems like we got a special guest up above.
Yeah, hold on. Yeah. I'm coming up to sort it out. Hold on, Natherul. Yeah, we're in a... I'm going to get you in here. There you go.
Hello.
Hey. Let's boost Natherul a bit up. There we go. So, crap, where am I? Here I am. So, right, Natherul is here. If there's a... So, you, Bombling, username saying about the hidden mechanics on the scenarios.
Yes. Well, that's something that I'd say in general, like hidden mechanics in general, is not a good idea. There are certain places where it's necessary, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
But in general, having something completely hidden on how it works is simply not a good idea. It's not a good experience for the player.
Yeah, I don't disagree if you don't know what you're doing, but that mechanic there, I mean, I think that that would be the responsibility of the players to inform the other players and build some sort of communication and connection between them, you know, be more interactive between each other. But as you said, overall, hidden stuff is definitely not good. So,
isn't that the place where it's so hard to punt away a tank from that little pit? Or am I thinking about something?
No, yeah, that pit is pretty much impossible to punt someone off because they will hit the edge.
So it's going to be a fun mess in that little pit from now on, I presume.
Yeah, well, in that case, yes, it was good that it was fixed because it was a dumb hidden mechanic. But on the other hand, it was also, I mean, the good part about it being broken in that way was the fact that if someone gets, like, if I get my BG down there, you're going to have a very hard time getting me off there.
Yeah. And that's a fun mechanic, in my opinion, that you can actually just hold that position as a tank and being able to guard your target, jump back and forth to be able to cap it where you need to. But this will make it even more interesting, in my opinion. And perhaps bumbling some AoE Bright Wizards around that spot for now.
No. I'm already next level here, mate. I'm thinking we need a cauldron so we can pour poison and morale damage down in that. I'm just memeing here.
I'll just save up some more of my Skaven mustard gas for you.
Yes, more Skaven.
All right, so we're done with this. Everybody happy with this? Move on. We've got a lot of patterns to go through.
Yeah, I thought the Winds of Insanity was going to be the juicy part, but
it is. We're getting there.
The flanks.
Well, you see, this is the thing. We might have think one thing might be the juicy, and I think that one, it will be a juicy one. We're getting next to that one. But the scenario is an important part of the game for a lot of people. I mean, I love scenarios. If you gave me a choice, open RVR scenarios, like for a whole 24 hours, I would just go for scenarios myself. I love them. So those changes are important to some people. And I don't think we should in any way neglect any of the population with patch notes coming into.
And I think it's important we make the disclaimer here that while we do have some strong Warband-minded players in here, we are not trying to make this like a pure Warband versus Warband podcast. When we go over the patch notes, we read them as players and just try to think, oh, what is this change going to mean for the gameplay? Like, if we see something in scenarios and we bring up a topic like this, well, we can go, well, what does this actually mean? Because if you're stuck in the murder ball, you need to kill whoever's standing on the flag to actually just get rid of them so you can capture the flag.
Yeah, that's why we have you and we have Claustro from the other side, the Destro side as well, so you can see the perspective of both. And I'm quite happy that Nath had the time to jump in. So if something comes up, we have the, I don't know what word to use, the insider, you know, the other opinion, you know, the third opinion there. So moving on from the scenarios there, we've got a message now displayed in the entire scenario when the flag starts being captured. That's also good because there have been a lot of scenarios won or lost like this because people are not paying attention. I think that will be a good option to bring back the attention into the things. Especially when there's Witch Elf, Witch Hunters that can stealth. People were losing that. I don't know if anybody wants to make a comment on that.
I would be very interested to see some data on how many matches are actually getting lost to ninja capping. It's just a fun fact for me to know that there is matches out there, and I'm curious to see, you know, how big of a percentage of all the ranked matches are actually happening to ninja caps. How many lost matches are suddenly turning into won matches due to ninja caps? I wonder how big this change is going to be for that sort of percent.
From the ones I've watched, I would give you a number from top of my head about 10 to 15%. No more. Most people like to kill in those ones, though.
Also, just as a normal player, when I speculate about why there is a flag in there, I see that as a mechanic to speed up the process. If it's a landslide and the other team is refusing to come down to fight because they feel defeated,
that
well, you can capture the flag, and that's why you have a really long cap timer on the flag. So I don't see the rank scenario 6 versus 6 Calder Woods with the flag as being a map focused flag. So I can see why this message is implemented. So if anyone is trying to use the flag as a win condition when they lose the fight, that's not the intention. That's just my guess.
Well, I always thought that that flag was, you know, if you're winning and the other guys don't come down, you cap it, you end it faster instead of waiting. That was the way I've seen it.
Perfect.
Yeah, is that what you think, Claustro, too?
Yeah.
It was never meant to be a winning factor. It was just like, you know, we're winning, this guy's not coming down, let's cap it and be done with it. That's how I've seen it. But we have Gory here on the stream that says he would like to see a scenario with no objective, just a deathmatch. 12 people per side enter once, you know, they go in and they just wipe each other to the end. That's it. That might be an interesting idea, like a good old bar brawl. That might be an interesting idea for a new scenario in the future.
Just to play the devil's advocate, if I'm playing ranged DPS and I refuse to come down since there's no war camp guards and you can't end the scenario before I'm dead up in my spawn, well, how will you fix that? I think the flag is a necessary evil for Caldor Woods, and that's why it has like a 50-second capture time. It's not meant to be you just walk up there and whoever gets there first win the flag. The flag is there as a backup mechanic for when it's a stalling match.
Okay.
I hope Gory was with us during the Halloween event with pumpkins. That sounds cool.
No more pumpkins. No more pumpkins, please. No more pumpkins. So moving on to the next, which the thing is the juicy one, as Claustro said, the abilities. So the first thing, they fixed an issue where deflect oil did not work. Okay, I think we can all understand that. That is a new ability they gave to tanks. So they can deflect some of the old, they can stand there a little bit longer. And yes?
We tried in our Warband on 7th Legion on order side to at least force the tanks to get that ability on the bar and try to play around with it. The first week, I volunteered as a guinea pig to run in and make the tanks pop that ability. And I still took 3k damage per tick and died like a motherfucker. Sorry for the language.
Yeah, that's all right.
But yeah, I ended up dead on the ground and we bug reported, okay, this is not working. So I'm glad to see it fixed. I haven't been able to test it yet, but I think it's very nice to get these arts type renown requirement abilities back in the game, because we had the bypass post on the melee DPS, and that's a wonderful ability. You can make so many cool plays with that.
Well,
now the tanks getting this deflect oil, I think that's a step in the right direction.
Claustro, you like this one for the tanks? Easier to siege with this?
Not particularly easy to siege. It's perfect for me, so I can raise my shield upwards instead of in front, so that's a good thing. Never mind. The damage that it reduces isn't that big. We haven't tested if it stacks. If you, for example, place four tanks in the same group and everyone presses deflect oil, do you take 0% damage?
It does not stack.
Okay.
Right, it doesn't stack.
It still doesn't help that much, but yeah, it's a fun ability that makes the game feel a bit more alive than earlier. And it can be useful, don't get me wrong, but it's...
Well, it's still the beginning. It might be modified in the future to be... Let me use the word better. I don't know. But, you know, usually when new skills have been introduced, they always start at some point and then they're working in to see how they go into the game. So since this one got in for the tanks, I wonder if we're going to see the rest of the of this type of abilities coming into the game. You know, like the rune priest that can heal the, for example, the ram, or the engine that can buff the ram, and all those other skills that existed.
Wasn't that in the patch note like 3 weeks ago that you now can heal the ram?
Yeah, let me add to that. Those aren't the abilities. That's the actual repair ram button use it.
Okay, I get it.
First of all, I'll add that Deflect Morale was even more shit on live, because it was 10% damage reduction. So it was, and also it was only you and two other players. I changed it to be your entire group if they're in range.
That's true.
As for the other renown abilities, there's one more that I would probably want to implement later, which is, I think it's called Clear the Skies, if I'm wrong there.
The name sounds familiar, I can't remember what it does.
It's reduced damage from the ranged siege weapon, and it's something that healers have. So like the cannon, AoE cannon and single target cannon.
That'll be cool.
That's cool, yeah.
The other ones, frankly, they're shit. The only one that isn't shit apart from those are the healing of keep doors, which currently we do not want to add in because that would detract from these supplies and what they actually do. But the other ones, like the healing of RAM and stuff, we're talking about healing about 0.5% of its HP. That's what it boils down to.
Yeah, it's not really a lot. I can totally get behind the thought process of not including, was it Bulwark from the tanks, able to heal Dorf by 5%? I can understand why you don't want to implement that without ITD players being able to hit the Dorf with abilities. Or...
Yep.
Okay. So, we're done with this. Move on. Anybody want to add anything?
Yeah. Jesus, I'm not so much here. Yeah. But in terms of the reflect oil or deflect or reflect, whatever it's called, only affecting party members and only being on a tank. So usually what you have when you siege a keep is four tanks on the ram. So I'm wondering if this is shaking up the meta. So you have players on the ram who are not tanks, but you have the tanks standing nearby them to give them the protection from their oil. Because the tanks, when they're doing the ramming mini game, I don't think they can use this ability, reflect oil, so they can't ram and protect themselves. So I'm just one. Okay.
They can pop out, do it, and then pop back in.
Yeah.
Okay, that's good to know how that can be used.
So since the oil was changed, I think it was last week, so it does just does more morale damage or, well, unmitigated damage. So it doesn't matter if you're a tank getting hit by it on the ram. So I just guess maybe having melee DPS on the ram now and then the tank standing nearby ready to reflect. I just wonder if that's going to be a message shift.
Well, that might need to make new tactics there, you know, have the ones that ram and the ones that deflect. You know, maybe we have to work out some new tactics there. Okay. We'll see how that's going to play out. We'll see. We need to test it a little bit before we start doing some more stuff. Tip Doom, they're not on the plan to do anything about the engineering skills there. This is the one, and then maybe something from the healers, and that's it, according to Natherul here. So the next one on the abilities is Wind of Insanity. Now can now be interrupted by pure interrupts. What I'm going to do at this point, give me a second because this is all new to me as well, is I'm going to play a little video so you guys can watch and see what skill we're talking about, and then we'll come back and talk with the guys about what this means for the Warband play, what that means for the Zealot. It's an ability from the Zealot. So give me a second. Let's see if I can make this work. I'm doing it right. All right, there we go. I'm getting this one right. Hold on. Let me make this a little bit bigger for you guys for a second. There we go. So I'm going to pause it when the time is so you can see that. So here's the Zealot in the middle. All right, he's going in. And you see that little purple aura around him and how the other warband has been pushed back. That is a triple punt. It'll be 1, 2, 3. Just watch it. I'll play it again so you know what we're talking about. See how the warband goes back and goes back again and goes. You see that this purple thing? That's the effect of the ability. And they get punted again. That's the third time. So let me go a little bit further back again. Let's see this again, how it works. So the Zealot goes in, punts once. People run in, he punts them again. It is a constant 3 times punt. And while that happens, the Zealot is immobile. It just stands still. He can't move. And can be interrupted. So that's where this ends. The rest of the video is just a continuation of the fight there. So let's go back to the other screen. Hold on a second. This is all new to me. There we go. All right. Let's go here. So let's see once again what the chat says.
What a great Winds of Insanity, Claustro. Yeah, thank you.
That was a video from Claustro. He delivered that one. He's right. Sorry, I'm new to this, man. I'm trying. But you're right, everybody should get the credit. This is my first number one rule on my stream, that anyone does anything should get the credit for what he does. And yes, that a good video showing clearly what the skill does from that one. Aeon Therb, the Squig Herder also has an AoE punt, but it's not a triple one.
Doglog, please don't speak about that, because that's our next counter to... delete your messages, please.
You heard it from Claustro there. So that's the ability, Wings of Insanity, for the Zealot. Now that ability can be interrupted. So since this is a Destro ability on the Zealot, we'll start with Claustro to tell us what he thinks about this change. Claustro, over to you.
Yep. As you can see in the clip, it's a game-changing ability that can win you the fight. I think it's a 24 or 30 second cooldown on that ability. And it doesn't grant any immunities to the three punts. You can basically follow that up with the Marauder Knockdown, and after that a Black Orc punt, or even a new Winds of Insanity. Against unorganized warbands, it's way too strong, as you can see in that video, because if you blob up like that, we can easily break up the blobbing. It's also very strong against more organized warbands like 7th, because when we see that they are moving in for the moral drops, we can save the Winds of Insanity to prevent them to drop the full damage. So the nerf is good and it was needed, but I'm not sure if it's the correct way to nerf it. We can speak more about it after Bombling has said his words on it.
Okay. Bombling, the word is... I don't know what the English word is. Anyway, you can tell us your opinion. I'll try and load up the points up with the War Builder while you talk.
So when I first read the patch notes, the initial thought of me was, okay, finally, because I think this ability was way too big of a playmaker tool due to many different things. First of all, it's a self-blessing, just to explain the ability. I'm not sure if Fixer is pulling it up now.
Yeah, I'm doing it now.
It's a self-blessing where you root yourself in place, and it's a toggled ability. So anyone who knows toggled abilities, you press it, and then the frame around the ability is going around and around as long as the ability is toggled. So it's not a pure channel ability as Hold the Line or Annihilate or any of these usual abilities. I pinpointed the keyword in the patch notes, Fixer, if you could pull it up again, the patch notes.
Yes, one second.
I pinpointed the ability that pure interrupts was going to interrupt the channel now. And unfortunately, that doesn't seem to be the case. It seems like all interrupts, both CC abilities and taunts and whatever else you have, will interrupt the ability. And I think this is an overnerf. Despite I've been the probably one of the most vocal players about, I think we needed this ability nerfed and changed. I think this is an over-nerf if it's not only going to be taunts and interrupting abilities, but if it's going to be all CC, and if it's going to be even the Zealot casting another ability, it will cancel the challenge. It seems to me right now, after testing it, after the nerf, that the ability is classified now as a pure channeled ability and not like some special... case.
So I have a question here. You might have said this and I might have missed it, so excuse me if I ask the same thing twice now. It says by pure interrupt, taunt, etc. What else is a pure interrupt? I mean, is punt a pure interrupt or not?
I'm not sure if Natherul
is challenge.
Is challenge this and...
I know like challenge interrupt stuff, punts do, knockbacks and stuff like that. So from the little
challenge does not interrupt stuff.
Okay.
That's a big common misconception on Return of Reckoning. Challenge is not actually interrupting abilities. Sorry, Akara, but it does.
Good. No, I'm learning. I don't know. So I'm asking because I'm sure other people have the same question. What are the pure interrupts?
I think on the Marauder, you have the Mouth of Zeints. That's like a challenge, but it's a pure interrupt, like the Taunt, but it's a...
So there are some abilities in the game. I think Taunt is the biggest example. Like whenever someone is casting something or challenging something, if a tank taunts the target, it will interrupt the cast with the text in the middle of the screen on the caster. Your ability has been interrupted. There are a few abilities like AoE interrupts on Marauder, I think it is, on White Lion. what else? Swordmaster has one as well. I guess Black Oak has a mirror. So that there are AoE interrupts, and when I read the patch notes and it says pure interrupts, I assumed it was gonna be interrupting abilities with the wording interrupt abilities in the tooltip.
Oh, and to add one more thing to it, before, when it was a toggle ability, the Zealot could use abilities while it was running. With the state right now, the Zealot can't use any abilities because that will break the toggle on. So you can basically call the new Winds of Insanity channel that roots you in place. And that's not something you want that high up in a tree anymore. It's a useless ability until they fix the things that Bombling mentioned.
Okay, so I wanted to say something for the thing. You said, Claustro, earlier that against the Pack Warband, that was a very strong spell and that needed to be nerfed. Do I remember correct?
Yeah.
So against the Packs, against the organized Warbands, it wasn't so much overpowering for some other reason?
It was. It's overpowered for many reasons, but the main problem is that there's no counterplay to it within the game. Mm. The old version, of course, you couldn't taunt it, you couldn't punt it, and that's way, way, way too strong. One thing that you can do that I don't know if Order tried is to fake it. Push in, pretend that you are doing your moral drop, eat the winds, and then go for it. That's the only counterplay in the game at the moment, and that's not enough.
A question for me. While the Zealot was doing this ability before they changed it, could you couldn't interrupt it, you couldn't stagger him or punt him away. It was just like, if he started it, he had to do it. There was nothing to do about it.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So by saying there was no counterplay, I would like to very strongly underline that there was absolutely no counterplay to it, because you couldn't taunt it before this nerf. You couldn't CC the Zealot, so if you tried to Zealot stagger or throw a landmine or throw a mage bolt to punt them back, there was no way of stopping the ability unless the Zealot ran out of AP. There's an argument, okay, you could just massively AP drain the Zealot, but all these suggestions to stop the Zealot coming in is more like predictionary counterplay to an ability that pretty much every Zealot in Warband play can pick up, because it's high in the healer tree and people don't necessarily take the single target stagger, so it frees up the mastery points. But it's a very deep conversation. I would rather try to keep brief
about this. So since the distraction side agrees that that was OP the way it was, and Order was saying it as well, so we all agree it was OP in the Warband play. Just to say that when it could not be interrupted, I just want to point out what Heladin says on the stream here, the fact that you could get to three or four Zealots, and if they're caught, they could rotate that in final situation. That made it even more strong, I think. So that change that I see here, it's definitely a good one, brings a little bit of a balance, because definitely I always felt, and I've said this to my stream for my character, that everyone should have a fighting chance, and when that was not interruptible, I don't think you had a fighting chance when that came onto play. So I think it's a good change.
May I add something to it?
Always.
From what Hiladin is saying, if you have the Winds of Insanity on anything else than the DPS Zealot, that group gonna die when the healing Zealot goes for the winds. So in theory, it's possible, it has been done, but practically it's not really working. But yeah, it's a way, way, way too strong ability, especially with the 24-man cap. And that's something I want to come back to, because I don't think the taunt part is the correct nerf to it. I think you can reduce it to, for example, 9 targets as one step. Another thing you can do is to increase the cooldown. The cooldown is way, way, way too low for something like that. Perhaps a 2-minute cooldown and try it on there. If that doesn't work, I think you can add the taunt mechanics to it.
So just bouncing off of that last comment and suggesting about 2-minute cooldown, the Rune Priest, and I don't want to make this a mirror example, but the Rune Priest has like an AoE res with 3-minute cooldown on the very same 13-pointer spot in the character builder. 3-minute cooldown, yeah, sure. It is this strong of an ability in the pre-nerfed stage. where you need a massive cooldown for such a massive tool, because this is technically a game-winning fight. If we go back to the Claustro clip where he shows Winsome Insanity, it's basically one player controlling up to 24 players and their location and his own warbands maneuvering while this six-second channel is going on with no counterplay. And I would like to go back to the key word here, counterplay, because I was big and loud about there should be counterplay visibility. And I think giving the counterplay is the right step, but giving the correct counterplay is the fine adjustment that we need on the ability right now.
Okay.
So at the moment, it's more or less a useless ability that will be really, really, really hard to pull off. Perhaps not the correct first step to do, but I agree it should be nerfed. It's that ability, it's a morale itself. It should be a M3, for example, for the setup. That's how strong.
I have no coding experience. I have no idea how to even tackle such a situation like this, trying to make this ability a perfect balance or a closer to perfect.
Well, I want to see it from the other, from a different perspective, saying that that ability was OP according to Warder and according to Destro. So both sides agree that ability, there was something that needed to be done about this ability. And even if according to you, maybe the taunt is, or the interrupt is not the, if you like, the 100% right way to go, at least it was identified and a step has to be made to the right direction. And I think through the gameplay and the feedback from the community, we'll see if that works right, or if somebody else through the gameplay can come up with a better idea to suggest to the devs to consider improving and making it more usable, if that word is good, usable into the gameplay later on.
Agreed.
You know, it's a step in the right direction, so we should be happy about it.
It just needs to be fine-tuned, in my opinion, because this is an over nerf, in my opinion.
Yes.
On the receiving end of this, week after week after week, this is an over nerf, because the beauty of this ability was you could control the battlefield, you could create a little zone where you could protect yourself from incoming masses, and you could protect other healers. You could even channel this and then make someone else go in front of you, and they could protect you while you could still cast abilities. It was a nice and it was a fun interactive tool. It just needed the counterplay aspect.
So,
and if it's just going to be interrupts, I'm more than fine with that. But old CCs and being unable to cast abilities while it's going, I think that's too much.
Yeah, okay. So we're on the right track. Let's leave that one there and move to the next one. Rune of Nullification and Charger stats will now only trigger off a single target abilities. So Rune of Nullification is a Rune Priest one. The Charger stat, is that the Doc one?
That's the Zealot one.
That is the Zealot one. Okay, hold on. Let me switch back to the game, to the browser to see those two skills. So on the Rune Priest, that one is
11 pointer left tree on both Zealot and Rune.
All right, random location. Critical attacks plays a debuff on the target that reduces all incoming healing by 50% for 10 seconds. So critical attacks, and that's on the Zealot as well. Let me see on the Zealot exactly, so we can show this to people. Plays a debuff. Oh, it's exactly the same skill. It's a 100% mirror skill. Okay. So instead of this, so no longer AoE healing debuff then.
No longer 50% incoming AoE healed above, yes.
Yeah, okay. So, both guilds, the Seven Legion and PMP, you mainly Warband guilds. So, let's start with Claustro. How do you feel about this? Was this something that was used widely on the Destro Warbands for AoE healing debuff?
If I would create a Warband and you would ask me what it's the first class you will bring to your warband, I would say the DPS Zealot because of the wins and because of the changer's touch. That's abilities that you need to get the warband scene going, and it's a huge nerf for both sides and for the warband scene. It's good that it happened on both sides, so we can't really complain about it, but this is one of those patch notes where we need some kind of description from the leads to tell us why this is done and what were the complaints of it earlier, what brought us to this decision.
Okay, let's see if what Bombling has to say about this from the order side.
When building, just to follow the same lineup as Claustro, when you build an order warband, DPS Rune Priest is not as high priority because it doesn't have the Winds of Insanity mirror. And on the armor AoE debuff tactic, you don't have a elemental AoE resist. So just comparing the two classes, DPS Zealot for warband play and DPS Rune Priest for warband play, the Rune Priest is not in high as the Zealot in demand, but it's still up there. It's still like the probably, as soon as you fill your first two groups, you want to look to get towards the DPS setup, because then you have the base critical mass, and then you need the Rune Priest to make the damage stick. So in terms of building the Warband, the DPS Rune Priest is very important, and it was a key role for pretty much many years of Warband play on both Order and Destro.
So...
And...
Yes?
The tactic itself ain't the big issue. It's again the 24 man cap. This is one of those tactics that you can tune down to, for example, a 9-man cap, so the character can still be played.
So if I listen to what you say right now, Claustro, you're saying that okay, we want the AoE healing debuff on the Zealot and the Rune Priest. And if it was felt that it was too much, it should be tuned down to 9 people instead of 24 for the cap, instead of making a single target a completely useless to warband play.
Yeah.
I think the main issue here, and that's just all the forum drama, is this ability on Zealot and Rune Priest, well, the tactic, 50% healing debuff is massive. But when you look at the requirements to actually get it functioning and look at how much uptime it has, technically, in a warband setting, yes, applying 50% incoming heal debuff to up to 24 people is insanely strong, and that's why it's so high priority. But when you start diving into how much coordination and how much group setup you actually need to get this effect, and then you take into consideration how this was even discovered, and figuring out last week how the devs wanted to tune this a notch, I just think it doesn't go hand in hand.
Mm-hmm. So there's a question here on the stream. It says, why 9 people and not 12? Actually, I mean, you know, half the warband. Is there a reason for the 9? Or
Yeah. That was the old cap. And if you watch the Slayer and Shoppa, for example, I think it's called Lots Just Shopping. Mm-hmm. And I don't know the Slayer version of it. It's capped at 9 for some reason. So instead of hitting 24, the Shoppa can only hit 9 players with that ability. No. And that brings Shoppas out of the Warband scene at the moment due to that.
Right. Okay.
So that's 9, but I agree with Tidum. 12 would be much better. And in that case, you need to raise the Rift and Magnet to 12 as well. And that might be too much.
Yeah, the one you're looking for on the Slayers is the accuracy tactic for the Slayer, the equivalent of the Chopper you wanted, that hits 9 targets with Flurry. So here's something I just thought about. We said it's 50% healing debuff. It was 50% at 24 people. You say it could be 50% at 12 or 9, okay? So I'm going to say, why not leave it at 24, but make it 25%? Would that make any difference? Or the 25% you feel it might have been too little as a debuff? I'm just trying to see other alternatives to this, because, you know, we're having an argument about this to become single target.
Can I?
Yes, of course.
Yeah. The Chosen has an aura that hits 24 players with exact 25% heal reduction. And that will make the Zealot version worthless. The Knight has the same thing, but reversed. It's not exactly the same. It's harder to use it. So for Order, it might be useful. I don't know. I don't think so. For Destro, it wouldn't. It's too low.
Okay.
If it was tuned down from 50% incoming heal debuff on appliance and to 25%, as Claustro said, it will pretty much be obsolete, at least for Destro. I'll have to think a little bit more on Order. But you have other avenues to getting this 25% AoE heal debuff. For example, the Bloodlord set for casters. You can get the same 10% proc chance just spamming Rain of Fire, plenty of AoE abilities. You have a chance to apply this ability. So the key role, and I think this is important to underline, that DPS, Rune Priest, and Zealot, they were not big killers. Yeah, they could steal some kills once in a while, but they were not the muscle damage. They were more of a debuff niche role. You bring one of them, you don't bring two of them to a warband.
It's too much uptime. You know, you need the guards on them and the healers, so you're wasting a lot of slots if you bring more than one. Just my opinion on that.
Speaking about the 50%, and that's being huge, if you compare that to how much increased healing there is in the game, those 50% aren't that much.
Yeah, especially in a warband, there's a lot of damage going on, a lot of heal. There's usually two healers per party, you know, there's a counter there. But here's the other side. How powerful, and I don't know if it's happened, right? How powerful was that 50% AoE incoming in a smaller scale on a 12-man or in a 6v6 situation? Do you think that this nerf or change is good for the smaller scale, but it really kind of like sucks for the warband, Bombling?
Well, it seems like a leading question, because it kind of is. This change stems from DPS doc, and DPS doc is funnily enough not mentioned here because it was already fine-tuned. DPS doc has the exact same tactic, but they had an easier solo way to apply this tactic. So they could heal debuff way easier on their own. So for small-scale, DPS doc is really good. They see a lot of play in rank 6v6, whereas the Zealot in DPS spec and the DPS Rune Priest does not, because they need a partner. They need a very specific setup to function, to even apply this debuff. And even so, they don't bring the same damage and whatever else the DPS doc brings for 6v6. So DPS Rune Priest and DPS Zealot, as we are talking about here, is not seeing play in rank 6v6 because it requires the setup. And this is just a result of, I would call it collateral damage, because they saw that Doc is applying this debuff way too easily on its own. And then they changed DPS Rune Priest and Zealot, who is not categorized as an issue in either small scale or large scale. Just simply to hit it with the wide nerf brush and just say, okay, this tactic on its own is overpowered. It's overperforming on Doc, even though the Doc has other ways of applying.
Yeah, Claustro, what's your thoughts on this one?
I agree. When our DPS Zealot had a break, I rolled one because the guild needed one and I enjoyed the playstyle. But it doesn't work in the 6v6 scene. I did scenarios, but you're basically useless with that spec inside.
I agree, especially on the ranked one. I'm just thinking that why was this change come upon? Does anybody from us, me, Bombling, and Claustro, or anyone on the stream, has an idea why this was done? I mean, it feels to me the way you guys are describing it, that was a very, very important skill to have on the warband.
Okay, so I think you need to see it from this perspective. If you watch that tactic and the description of it, and it says 50% heal reduction, and compare that to the heal reduce in other games, for example, that 50% is huge. But take in consideration that in this game you're also amplifying the healing a lot more than other games that I've played. So that's one way to tune down the increased healing numbers there,
right,
at the moment.
That's it. So question. So do we think, I would like Bombling to answer first. Do we think that's a good change or a bad change?
It depends on...
on the warband, Is that a good change or a bad change?
But once again, it depends if you see it from an organized point of view where you have this tool, or if you see it from a pickup warband where you just run around and you don't have this sort of coordination where you get a DPS Rune Priest online, or a DPS Zealot for that matter. Because you need the Winds of Insanity or the... the WAG on the Black Orc to even make this. It's 90% of the setup is having the cooldown increase in the party and coordinate it when you need it, where you need it, and how you apply it. So to get back to your question, sorry for sidetracking here, but is it a good change? I don't think so. I think this was a key role that is now completely getting ripped off and destroyed. And I think the reasoning is a very hard pill to swallow.
Okay. Claustro, what do you think? Good or bad?
It's a bad change. This will drive the game more to the moral drops and the pressure of the morales to get the kills. With a 50% heal debuff up on a Destro Warband and coordinate it with the Flashfire procs, for example, that's so much pressure that the Destro Warband can't cope with. And yeah, that's a tool that both sides needs to rely on killing players without morales. And with this change, we need the morales even more.
Well, I don't want to get into a morale discussion. That's another big, huge topic, maybe some other time. So don't overexpand on that one, please. So, Bombling, go on to what you said. I just wanted to make this little parenthesis. Don't go into the morale discussion.
Yes, I will avoid that. It's something we can bring on in another episode. I wanted to talk about... I forgot my thought of... train of thought here.
Sorry.
Give me like 2 minutes. You can continue.
Okay, well, I don't have anything else to say about those skills myself. So, but so far, I don't know if the audience is finding this interesting, but I do because we get both sides here. We're talking about big war bands and stuff. And I'm happy to see you guys are also interacting with the chat there. So if you have any questions about this or any, you know, I didn't understand this or that, please do feel free to type it. See if the guys can answer.
I remember my train of thought now. If you don't have anything,
come on, Rasen. No, on the abilities now. I mean, the what we got left here is to do a quick run through the rest of the stuff that they patched, and then we're gonna go into the game. We're going to have a quick look today on the set. So, okay, moving on. Crafting. The other changes for the patch notes on Saturday was crafting. Making potion will now send a message to the chat about making the item. Okay, it's a good thing. So we know, you know, if we're lagging or not, at least. Health bar display going up and down constantly when you are in a champion. That's also a good change there. So you know what the hell's going on. Yes, somebody wants to say something or?
Okay. I just said it's very good. I've been champion in both the testing phases of cities and also since they released now one or two times. I've been lucky enough to get champion in stage 3. And when you constantly had your health debar not adjusting because it was not coded to be 10k or 100k or how much else HP you have as a champion, and your health bar was just constantly bouncing up and down. And it was very hard to get a grasp of, okay, should I pull out? Am I healthy or should I stay in? And then does my healers have me? Mm-hmm. So it's a very good change, very needed.
Sorry, just another parenthesis here. Because, we planned 30 minutes, but are you guys okay to do the sets or do you want to do them next week?
It's all good.
Hmm? Sorry?
It's all good. It's all good.
Okay. So Fortress attempted to fix issues that caused contribution to be added. Also important, we had a lot of bitching about that. It's good that it's been resolved. Quests been fixed. I don't know much about the quest, but it's definitely good for those that love PvE to have this corrected. It's a promise of battle, encroaching darkness, and love lost. I'm just reading this to be fair to everybody on all the categories of the game. Then Tome of Knowledge, a lot of unlocks I see here have been fixed. I also get quite a few when I do scenarios and stuff, they keep popping. They've been reset it and they've been reapplied. So going down to the items here, Warlord and Sovereign gear are technically active. Not all procs are final. 7 pieces subject to be intended theme. Power bonuses as percentage should be flat. That's the thing that surprised me. I'm like, whoa. Also seen Groll said that the Magus Sovereign 7 piece changed. So we're gonna go in the game and check them out quickly because it was planned for 30 minutes, but it's okay. 8-piece granted ability, however, client limitation do not allow the tooltip to display. So that's also a surprise coming up. Cities need to be talked about. EU fights and zoner never get a chance to city siege until 2-3 a.m. U time. You can now make EU. We did mention that, Aeon, a little bit earlier on. There's nothing we can do about it. The population is high. It's not something, you know, we can do about that. Currently match those found on the main sovereign set. Mastery points. So we're gonna get a mastery point and an activated ability, look like. Okay, and then some tickets have been resolved as well. You can read those on your own time. And that's the patch notes. So let me jump into the game and switch to like this.
I just want to add that the mastery point, they, depending on if we fix that, if we manage to fix that or not, they might be entirely replaced with something else.
Sounds good to me. But that's just my initial thought, that some builds have like way bigger benefit of having one additional mastery point, whereas other builds just have, oh, I can spend like one more mastery point in the actual mastery path and just get like four more ability damage. So mastery points are a very big deal.
For example, my build, the tanky build I ran with my NG, doesn't really need another point. I mean, I could use a proc like a shield or, you know, like the oppressor gives parry, dodge, and stuff like that. Yes, Max, that is Natherul, and you're more than welcome to join us if you want. If you come over to Discord, just let me know. I'll give you the rights for this new channel we have for this podcast weekly discussion, again through the patch notes. If you want to join us, you're welcome. So in the palace in Aldorf, I haven't been twice here to know where they are, but I think they might be in that weird big building with a change. We have the sovereign set. I have set it just to the NG. So it is an 8-piece set at the patrons now. There's still a few things missing. Like on the 6-piece, you can see it says, let me go to big screen for this so you guys can see this clearer. Anyway. So the 8 is still missing, and the 6 piece says 1 willpower, just that would be changing. So Claustro and Bombling, which set would you like to show to people? Is there a specific set you had in mind, or?
I've checked all of them on order site, and I assume they're perfectly mirrored to the archetypes and Destro. I don't have confirmation on that, it's just my assumption. Some of the sets that stuck out to me was one of the tank sets get a taunt when they get hit on a 10% chance.
Yeah,
that seems really powerful.
That is the tanks. Okay, let's...
Yeah, that's the offensive version of Sovereign.
Okay, so hold on a second. I'm on order, okay? So the first one that comes up for me is Ironbreaker. You want to check this one, or do you want something else to check what they do? Well, the tanks all get the same. So on this sovereign set, they get strength, wounds. That's a DPS set here.
Check the warlord one. That's the one with the taunt.
The warlord one. Okay.
Warlord Ironbreaker set. Yeah.
Okay. Let's try it. Sovereign here as well. Sorry, I don't know the vendors by heart yet. So. All right, there were warlord, and this is Ironbreaker. So, this is a defensive one, and the guys are talking about. They get 75 strength, 83 weapon skill, 6% armor penetration, 99 melee power, the 6 bonus we will see, and the 7th one is on being hit, 10% chance to detaunt a target.
And remember, that's on the offensive one, not defensive.
Yes,
If it was on the defensive one, it would have been...
My bad. Sorry, that's the offensive. Sorry, my bad. So... on being hit to detaunt, you say this is a powerful proc. Do you understand that correct?
It could be in Warbands if the set were defensive from the beginning and adding a 7-piece bonus like that, depending on how much the detaunt is for. Is it AoE or is it from the single target that attacked you? Yeah.
But here's my question. Okay, let's say... So don't make another mistake. This is something a tank in this set can be used by a tank for DPS, right? A two-handed tank. Yes? Or do I have this wrong?
I'm not sure. Let Bombling...
It has armor penetration, it has melee power, so I'm assuming all the statistics and weapon skill are defensive. It's a defensive two-handed set. Okay. So either way, this is my question. Why is an automatic detaunt that powerful?
I think it's just interesting to see, like, previously we have seen with, I think it's the Dominator set for the offensive scenario tanks. When they go two-handed, they have a chance to taunt the target. Now we see a chance to detaunt the target. I think it's an interesting curveball to throw. I can't really grasp yet exactly what it's going to do, especially if we get scenario sets later on where it's going to cater more towards that sort of playstyle. But just the fact that there is a chance to detaunt the target now when you get hit, that's a lot of defensive capabilities you get just on the chance to get hit. And that's the only thing I wanted to pretty much highlight with this.
Yeah, so this one has a great utility on when there's a lot of people. So suppose if everybody's hitting you and you're a tank, you're going to get hit. It's like giving you an AoE detaunt in already increased defenses. So you will go down even slower. And I don't know, because the description here on the tooltip is not clear to me. The question is this, does this thing have a cooldown or the 10% is always on? Like it hits you, you detaunt. If you don't hit the target, it gets detaunted for how long? Next hit can detaunt again. It's a constant thing. That's one thing I don't understand, because a detaunt like this, it is strong when you're trying to survive. Does anybody know this?
I think it's something we will have to dive into when we get later into the process and people start obtaining these gear pieces, and if we see something that is in need of fine-tuning. If it doesn't have an internal proc cooldown, well, that's something we can dive into when we start getting some feedback of how these sets perform. But right now, we can just window shop and see all of these cool
set bonus. What else we got on this one. What's the name? Just a quick thing. Slayer, just do the seventh piece only for today. Just see. Slayer gets to remove AP from the target. Okay. What's this one? Rune Priest get 10% chance to reduce incoming damage by 4%. That's also quite powerful. That will increase the survivability of Rune Priest by a lot. What is this? NG gets chance to reduce armor for 6 seconds. One proc, one CD, okay. What else we get here? Witch Hunter, 25% chance to remove 8 morale. Wow. I think I talked about this on my stream there. And how do you guys feel about this one? On B hit, 25% chance to remove 50 morale from the attacker.
That's one of the cases where I'm very interested to see if that's an internal cooldown, because 25% is really high. And if you just make a tanky witch hunter and throw him into a ball and give him proper support so he's just standing there debuffing people's morale.
That's what I thought when I first seen it. What do you think, Claustro, about this? I mean, I think the witch elf gets the same. I mean, do they gain right now a place in a warband as punchbacks for morale drain?
No. I like the idea of the bumbling saying. I haven't seen this one until now. So my head is full of things to try to utilize it. But I don't think at the moment you can do anything with it. But it's a cool addition. And hopefully we can do something with it in a warband setting.
Well, I was considering this on my stream yesterday. I was looking at this and I thought, at these classes, you know, because usually people say that the Witch Elf and the Witch Hunter, they don't have a place in the Warbands with a Quarren build. They have no AoE, Warbands are full AoE and all that. And I was just wondering if they can become, no offense for the use of word punchbacks for draining morale, they gain a place in the Warband with this set, effectively. Not that they will, just the first impression, the way I've seen it. We'll see if it's going to be implemented something for them to...
Well, with the nerf on the DPS a lot, it's really, really hard to find use of a Witch Elf in a Warband at the moment, because with the DPS Zealot and a Witch Elf in the same party earlier, you could buff the morale of the Witch Elf with Shamans and get that guy to M3, the crit morale, and you can pop that to give the DPS Zealot 50% crit. And that would be a cool combo, but with the nerf of Zealot, it doesn't work anymore. And with the nerf of, I don't know the name of it, the dragon gun on the order side, it doesn't see any play anymore.
Well, from the sets I've seen so far, I think we are ahead of us. We have a long way of getting them, the way cities are going. And we're going to see some interesting builds and new composition. I think we're moving to a new era of warband composition with this. And I'm saying this by looking at the Warlord key mantle of the Bright Wizard. I'm assuming the mirror on the Destro is the same. Bonus is there. The 7-piece says, on hit, 10% chance to increase all damage taken by your target by 4%. So I'm assuming with the massive AoE the Bright Wizard has, that will be a sweet damage increase for the whole Warband, right, Bombling?
It's going to be one of those sets. I seem to pick up on a theme here throughout the Warlord sets. They're kind of like the utility and the debuff sets, or debuff or buff sets, I should clarify. So, for example, on the Bridal side here, I assume it's going to be the same for the Sork and maybe even the Magus. Mm-hmm. So you have these casters now with Warlord available, where you can go into slotting one guy in your Warband if you're in a min-max Warband, where you have one guy running the Warlord set to debuff all your targets you're fighting to boost the rest of the Warband.
Let me do, because I have a note there from Asian Edgar on the stream that says, on your target is the key here. It's only on your target, doesn't proc on AoE.
Yeah, and I think I mentioned this on your stream yesterday, that we have seen this proc before on Bright Wizard and Sork, and we saw it on the 2-piece Overlord set, if you remember that, yeah, from the seals, the green and the purple seals.
I have
seals.
It on my end, yeah.
It was the same wording on the proc, and that meant that if you ran this set, you couldn't apply it on AoE. It's only whoever you have targeted. Even if you're hitting all of the people around them, it's only the people you have targeted, so one guy at a time.
Oh, okay. So it's not as good as I thought then. There we go.
It might be a really good single target set.
Oh yeah, for single target. Yeah, the way it was worded, and I know it says your target, but I wasn't sure how it works on the AoE. I thought it would apply to the AoE as well. But it's nice that it's been clarified for me. Warrior Priest, on hit, 10% chance to gain 50 morale. I'm assuming that will be applied on the dock as well. Faster morale building. I suppose that's going to come handy. Swordmaster gets the detoned. So that's there for those classes. Shadow Warrior gets the armor debuff. Yes, Claustro?
Can I add something? The cloak for the Warrior Priest, that's the DPS one. I can see some strength and some weapon skill. Is it the same on the healing one?
Which one would be the healing one? I need to. Is there two sets of Warlord? There's only one, this one.
No, okay. The Sovereign.
I have to go to the Sovereign and have a look. Not a problem. I mean, we've seen this one.
I haven't watched those because the DPS Warrior Priest. I don't know what they would
see.
Benefit
this
from.
One
from
is... No, it's not this one. You want the other one.
There was some block.
Hold on, let me find the Warrior Priest on this. Ah, there we go. Strength, wounds.
So it seems like the Warrior Priest and Dark is getting one two-handed for the Warrior Priest, one like pure DPS, one shield with the
this
block.
This is for the shield,
the
10% chance to recover 60 action points over 3 seconds. So he has to attack to get that. Yeah, that's the shielded one. You want the other one, Claustro? Let me see the other one. I'm not familiar with the classes, so I'm going left and right a little bit. So Warrior Priest and this one. Witch Hunter. There we go. Willpower wounds plus 50% critical damage taken, 6% healing critical chance, and anytime you block an attack, you will gain 60 action points over 3 seconds.
So it's two shields. It's weird.
It says anytime you block an attack, so.
Yeah, and the other one has the block in it as a set piece bonus.
Sorry, just that Wanaka says ignore this set, the 7-piece is wrong. Wanaka, do we know what this is gonna... Oh, the 7 pieces on the Warrior Priest are all mixed up. 50% critical damage taken is supposed to be minus 15% critical damage according to Grimnir. Okay, yeah. So this set needs to be reworked a little bit before we talk about it.
So it seems like they can code the tooltips to have a minus instead of a plus. So that plus 15% critical damage taken is going to be minus 15% critical damage.
Well, yeah, it's,
just like, you know, anti-crit on the.
But this to be funny as much as I can. But imagine if that was actually correct. You know, you put the setup and you get 15% more damage, as opposed to how strong you have to be to give you more damage. Okay. All right, I think we're going to leave it at this point here with the set, because we need to look into them a little bit more detail, both Bombling, I think, and Claustro, and me, mainly me, so we can talk about them. And we already, instead of 30 minutes, we are 1 hour and 20, and it's getting a bit late for me. I don't know, guys, Claustro, you want to say something in closing with this? For the guys?
Say again.
I think it's time to close the stream now, because we've overextended the time. At least for the first one, I think it went well. So if you want to say some final words for this stream to people before we close, please feel free.
Yeah, I want to do a huge shout out to Isra from 7th Legion, the Rune Priest, the deepest Rune Priest. Hope you enjoy the NG. And the same to Tatiana from PMP, our DPS Zealot, who's also rerolling another class. So good luck with that, guys. We're gonna help you if you need.
Okay.
And just to follow that through, I would like people to check out PNP streams if you want to see a Destro Warband point of view. Claustro is leading that stream from his guild. I'm doing it from my own stream. I don't stream for money or avenue. I don't stream to get fame or anything like that. I just stream mainly so I can get bots myself, but I very much enjoy when people come in and ask questions. So I would like to check, I would like for the viewers to check out both my stream, Claustro stream, and Fixer stream. And thank you, Fixer, so much for doing this on your channel.
No worries. I'm quite happy to help the community. It looks like a good idea. It looked like we had people watching and interacting. We'll see what the feedback from the guys are. Also, we need to give a big thanks to Natherul, the dev, who joined us and clarified a few things during this session. Natherul, thank you very much for jumping in. It's always nice to have you on board, you and any other member of the dev team. I've said this before.
No worries. I didn't really add much to the conversation.
Well, you did. Just the fact that you guys are present on this, and you, I don't know if this is the right expression, I apologize in advance, you were on call on Discord if something came up that we didn't understand, something we misunderstood, because I feel this helps also to improve the communication between the dev team and the community, you know, because we can read something and understand A when actually might mean B, and it's nice to have someone on board. So for me being the host, thank you very much for coming on board on Discord. Guys, it is past my bedtime. we'll try and do this every Monday for, well, it seems like it will take us an hour around the 30 minutes, so we need to calculate that in our own schedules. I did the best that I could in the short notice to get this one done. I hope you guys liked it, and I hope some of you learned some things. I hope some of you clarified some questions you might have had. And I don't have something else to say except thank you very much for being here. We are coming to an end of the stream at this point. So I don't know if anybody on the stream or anybody on the guest here wants to say something else. Put it in a calendar. This can be really useful. Kaladin, no need. It will be every Monday. Same time, 10 o'clock GMT plus 2. Is the time that we're going to be doing this. So every Monday we're going to have this little, what we're going to do every Monday is this little chat. For now I think we're going to be with Bombling and Claustro. Maybe in the future it'll be other people joining us, and we're going to try every Monday to analyze and explain the patch notes from the Saturday. We're going to try and see all the new things that come in, how they affect the warbands, the 6v6 from the perspective of Destro and Order. We're going to try and see where we are going with the new set, new items, and anything else that gets introduced into the game. I think that the way the patch notes have been going in the last, let's say, 1 month or so, there's always something to talk about and analyze. There's always questions, ideas, and I hope, with the help of Claustro and Bombling and Claustro, that we will be able to help the community to understand this, maybe reduce a little bit of the toxicity that comes sometimes, because we sometimes all overreact when we read something. And we'll see how it's going to go in the future. So, before I go, tonight, I think, guys, we need to raid somebody from the Warhammer community.
Very good idea.
And we're going to raid a new streamer today. So I would really appreciate if you guys chill around for to do the raid. If you don't like it, you can always leave later on. There's a new guy that streams. And I think we're going to raid him today. So a new member, a little bit of love before we go for the day. I can actually manage to get this one going. Come on, Fixer, you can do this. Ah, there we go. 24-hour stream. Oh, Max, no, man. Last time I did it, it destroyed me. Last time, it destroyed me, so no. Right. Raid is loading up. We're going to raid a new streamer that came out to our community. I hope you guys enjoy the stream and the podcast. Podcast will be every Monday, 10 o'clock. 10 o'clock GMT plus 2, you know my time.